our interaction with the people involved in the project, for us to do a project well, rapport or relationship needs to be built. And one way of building relationships in a project is to ensure stakeholders are managed. Don't let stakeholders manage the project people. Otherwise, the project people will just be yes, become yes, yes, and very abiding or very accommodating. We do not want to happen. They will steer the project away from our true intentions. What we should do in project management is that we project managers and the team, we manage the stakeholders instead of that managing us. That is the way. Now, having said that, we manage the stakeholder. How do we manage that? How do we manage them? Well, strategies need to be devised. Strategies need to be planned out. Yeah, isn't it? We plan out strategies on how to manage the stakeholders, especially the key stakeholders who are decision makers for our project. Those are the ones who can actually make or break our project. Now, this document is a very sensitive document. You wouldn't want this one here to fall into the wrong hands. Why? Because inside this would have the so-called, now it may sound negative to you, the words I'm going to use, our strategy, which is manipulative. Now, as project managers and teams, we utilize politics. Okay. Politics here is to bring the situation or environment of the project in our favor to get things done right time, right cost, and the right quality to our customer, for customer acceptance. So whatever it takes, basically politics is about whatever it takes to make our project delivery successful to the customer expectations. And that may even include manipulative strategies on our stakeholders to get that through. And those so-called manipulative strategies, people inside here. Imagine if this one is known by the stakeholder, they take a look, oh, so this is how you were actually trying to manipulate me. Now, remember the example I gave to you yesterday about the company that produces the handphone, smartphone, and the smartphone goes missing and so on and so forth. And the sponsor was so reluctant to sponsor you money to invest in additional CCTV and deterrent technologies. And the project manager was so basically unhappy because the sponsor is not being accommodating for the interest of the organization to reduce theft in the company. So he has no choice but actually to manage the sponsor so that the sponsor will okay the investment. How? By getting the sponsor, why don't you become the project champion for us? You know, the initiative of having the additional CCTV will help to deter theft. So we cannot eliminate theft, we will actually reduce the theft in the factory by having the CCTV around. You know it's going to reduce it, right? Why don't you become our project champion, project leader? Okay? Don't worry. We will do the work. We as project managers will do the physical, the infrastructure and so on and deliver those results for you to see. You just be there to be the key decision maker, become the sponsor, to deliver the disbursement of the funds at the right time, at the right place and so forth. We do the rest. All the glamour and the glory of success, we give to you. Don't worry about us, we give it to you. We accredit the success of this project, success, onto you. So it looks good on your resume, on your portfolio, or whatever it may be. Okay? So you can go and with your head held high up and tell your colleagues how much you have saved the company, how many million, how many thousand. So it's a manipulative strategy. We are trying that out because we were working on the basis, you know. If I need your help, right? You help me, I help you. Transactional, power basis that we are actually enjoying under Microsoft, project management. They're using transactional personalities or transactional leadership style. Okay? You help us, we in turn can help you to find glory and glamour as a project champion. So we put that strategy technique inside here. So if these things were exposed to the sponsor, somehow the sponsor got a copy of this here. Okay. So it was a plan. So it's not really sincerity on your part. Right? So it's actually getting me worked up. No, that will be very destructive. Yeah? Okay. So please keep this confidential. Only very few eyes can see, especially the automatic will be able to see, but not to be released everywhere. So, managing stakeholder. So we have the stakeholder managers. Now, stakeholders come and go. Stakeholders retire, they resign, or they are no longer around in the world. New stakeholders can come in. Worse still, I've seen in IT projects before, the whole user group being changed. A new user group comes in with another set of requirements different from the original one. Imagine if that ever happened. Well, that's a fact of life. You have to accommodate those change requests. Okay? It's always a risk and certainty there. Right? Especially that when there is a management buyout, a new user comes in also. So, would that disrupt your plan? Well, have you got your plans or projects so accommodating or so flexible or so, I would say, ready, right? For such eventualities? Well, that's how you put inside your risk management plan. So one of the risk management plan, of course, we'll cover in the afternoon, could be to look into occasions or even possibility occurrence of stakeholder changing the entire requirements. Not just inserting additional requirements as a change request, but removing the earlier requirements and set up a new set of requirements. It's like asking you to redo all the project all over again. Worse still, if you are 70% of completion and a new requirement comes in and then we start all over again. This is also a risk. Have you factored that risk as in the project risk? So that is a case of another story and for another time. But we would need to manage our stakeholders. Don't let them manage us. Okay? Don't let the situation manage us. We manage the situation. So, going further, stakeholders can come in. New stakeholder comes in, again, we have to redo this. To those new stakeholders that just came in. Again, we go through the communications management plan again. This new stakeholder, what are their needs and expectations of communications? What kind of details I need to release? How often? Again, all of this stuff. How are we going to release it? So, happens. So it's called managed stakeholder engagement, which will be represented as change requests. In this, 13.4 is a process whereby stakeholder, just imagine the stakeholder starts to lose interest in the project. That sponsor we were talking about earlier, who wants to become a project champion, or rather we delegate the person to become a project champion, somehow starts to lose the momentum or continuing to support. He's trying to reduce his support, maybe for other priorities of his work, or maybe the person being kept informed of the project progress. So the sponsor feels, well, I'm not even being updated, I'm not even being kept in the loop, communications loop. Of course, that's the failure of the project manager of not doing his duty in communications management. So that sponsor feels, I don't think I'm needed anymore. I don't think I'm being valued as a project champion anymore. So it's going to go off, it's going to retreat. Imagine you have just lost a loyal supporter. We do not want that. Okay? Any slightest sign of waning support should be immediately addressed. That's the duty of the mind, that's the belief. So of course, who will be the ears and the eyes? Well, the team members are the ears and the eyes when they are awaiting support. And of course, the team members will be the one who will be, what they call it in Bahasa, peker. In other words, in English, we call it very sensitive and being very alert of signs of impending distrust or loss of support. Okay? So, the team members have to utilize skills like interpersonal skills, communication skills, to give all those telltale signals, able to pick up all those telltale signals if they are awaiting support. Or it could be the other way around, the plus point. The person was originally very resistive of your project, or very neutral. But now, it's starting to gain interest, this stakeholder, starting to see the value to him or herself if this person participate and continue and to support the project. Now, it could be that. So once you see there is an opening, your people should be able to take on that situation and grab hold of this opportunity. Okay? Don't let it loose. It's better to have more friends than to have enemies to the project. Having enemies to the project does not increase project success. It's actually the reverse of it. Right? So we have more friends, more support, the more chances from grassroots as well as top management supporting project. There you go. These are all plus points. That's why managing stakeholders, you know, unfortunately, has not been, making very key interest among many project managers, because project managers were thinking traditionally, but as project manager, I just have to deliver results, just deliver technical stuff and so forth. Things of managing people and so forth, I leave my project team members to do it for me. I as a project manager, I just want to make sure my gun chart, my schedules, my costings are all delivered. But no. Okay. Not in this certification course. It says that, well, it's our duty, not just a project manager, but even the team to participate in stakeholder management. Okay, let's look into detail now. Every of this process to pick up if anything that we have not discussed will be captured and we'll discuss now. Right. So stakeholders can only be people, groups, or even institutions that you have interactions with in this project. So if you are doing a construction project in Kajang, for instance, I'm sure you will have to interface with Pejabat Tanah, the government office. You have to interface with the Majlis Pemerintahan Kajang, the Kajang Municipal Board, because they are the approving parties and so forth. So it's not just only among people, but also with government institutions and non-government institutions. Now, imagine the project you are doing is a construction project, perhaps a flyover project, okay? A bridge or flyover, and there are residents already occupying that space, and you have a high flyover which will cause traffic and noise and pollution and so forth. Residents around that area, the affected area, they will launch a protest because the value of the property will drop. It won't be the interest for them to support a flyover, even though it may convenience them in their travel, but they wouldn't want to have a flyover at the back of the garden. No one wants that, right? So here, you have a case whereby residents are against a project. But you as a developer, or you are as the highway construction company, you would need to support the project because that is a great factor of making sure this project gets successfully done. But there are protests. There are people who are resisting the project. Now, what if we just say, well, don't care about the stakeholders, they are just noisemakers, and there's only about 100 of the residents anyway, you know? And this is a multi-million dollar project. Not because of a few hundred here, we have to abandon the project idea. Obviously, it won't be our interest, because we are building the highway for the greater good of more than just 100 people. Maybe even millions of people, at the expense of 100 people who are complaining. Okay? Now, if you just ignore them, they will say that, well, you are having what I call it, a bullying tactic, okay? You are insignificant. Now, if you leave it at things like this, this disgruntled 100 packs of people, residents here, they find themselves not being represented, being bullied by all these big boys like yourself and so on, then they will go to opposition parties. They go to NGOs. They go to whoever who want to take up the case, or even legal experts to take up the case and try to win for them, to sue the companies that were building their bridge or flyover. So at the end of the day, from a resident resistance, it became a legal resistance to you. What if they're able to have a stop work order for whatever reason? What happened to the project? Stopped. When is it going to continue? No, no. Again, adding up on your threat risk. So, what's the lessons learned here? Just because there are a few of them there, it doesn't mean you ignore them. You still have to swallow your pride and approach them. Approach them. What for? They will of course tell you, no flyover around our place here. It won't be good to us and so forth. And you cannot say, sorry, let's remove the flyover. You can't even say that. So what we do is that it could be another project could have been issued out, which we call CSR, Corporate Social Responsibility, under the guise of CSR, if you can put under this label, where we address the residents' concerns, either to relocate them, okay, or if it's not a big issue, maybe to put in sound barriers or some soundproof certain areas, or of course, if it had been considered earlier, maybe some realignment of the highway and so on, if things were to feel that bad. So let me give you an example that happened in a neighboring country, which I had the privilege of doing some training at. This company is in a neighboring country down south, more down south. Okay? They have a plant. It is actually a beverage plant. Beverage plant. I don't mind telling you the company name. It's called Nestle in Indonesia. So this plant, their site, during construction, I mean while it was in construction, of course this is the main road, and there is an access road to the plant. So it is a clay road, it is clay road, sand road. So passing by some kampungs, kampung 1, kampung 2, kampung 3, whatever it may be. And interestingly, during construction, where the lorries go in, the contractors were doing, and they were building up their plant here, our friends from the kampung folks, they barricaded the road. Why? To make some money out of it. Toll plazas. They're makeshift toll plaza. So you pay some few thousand of rupiah, open up the boom gate to go. Then another boom gate, another 1,000. Anyway, of course, you say, well, not the issue for us. Anyway, it's a contractor doing the job. The contractor has to pay for those costs and so forth. True. When the site is ready and handed over to Nestle, this Nestle will inherit this problem. It will be passed over, right? Doing this. So before that happened, that is where the proactiveness of that is actually a project of their own also, even though they're not doing the work, contractors are, but in the ownership of the project, they have to take care of it also. So what they did was, the masale, or the Swedish director, okay, who is overseeing this project site, was the plant director there. The director and the local managers or key higher managers, took the trouble to go to each kampung, meeting up with the village head. To us, it's called Pemudu lah. To them, it's called the Tiptoe Kampung. And bearing gifts lah. So basically, go to kampung and say, okay, Pak, Ibu, okay, tolong bukakan jalan. Please remove the barricade so we have ready access. Don't have the barricade anymore because our staff will now, when this go online, our staff will go in and go out. You know, they're coming with shifts and so on, whole 24 hours. So we really want the cooperation. Kerjasama tuan dan ibu dan bapak. Now, of course, transactional again, transactional leadership style. You expect, what do I gain from doing that? Because there's one income which you're asking me to remove. Okay, Pak Ibu, what do you want? Let us know. Okay? We come like Santa Claus to you now. You just tell me what is your Christmas shopping list to us. Right? Your shopping list. Let me know what do you want monthly or yearly. We are not talking about bribery here. Okay? We are talking about these things given to the villagers, not just the Pak and Ibu, villagers here. You want to call this under CSR? It depends how you want to label it. That's up to you. Community engagement project, whatever labels you want to use, it's up to you. Okay, so you expect the same. That'd be good. And they did not stop there. No? These guys did not stop. Now, why did that foreigner come in together with the foreign, together with the local managers? It's because these people are able to see their sincerity. The foreigners coming in at that humble level to meet up with them. Not because this is sitting on the throne or whatever it is. Coming down to that level to talk to the Pak and Ibu in a very polite manner. So they say, okay, these guys are sincere. I mean, it's not like there's air in the head or they become very snobbish and so on. So that's showing sincerity and humbleness. That's one communication skill set that we're using, interpersonal skills. Very good. Now, coming back to this again. No problem, we provide you this. And they say, we want to provide you a little bit more. Now, this extra thing was not even asked by any one of them. But it was given in addition to this. Now, of course, you will say, what sort of people who want to give more when the customer does not even ask for it?
Donation.
Yeah, like what we call gold plating. If a customer is happy with silver, give silver. Why you want to give gold? But there is a purpose there. There is a value added. Now, you know what this thing is? This extra stuffing? It's this. Pak dan Ibu, okay, if you have any children in your village, or youth, or teens, okay, who you think they can study very well, okay, in schools, in secondary schools, we will sponsor them into the varsity level, into the university level, in college and so on. All expense paid, wherever they are in Indonesia, okay, we will sponsor. That's scholarship. When they graduate, come and work for us. That's part of the bond requirement. They work here. Okay? Immediately, they go into junior management. They don't have, because of that caliber. Okay? Now, of course you say, okay, thank you very much. So, exactly what really we gain from it? That's what I say. Pak and Ibu, you tahu. He said, when your children grows up, you are very fearful that they will leave the kampung to the big cities in Jakarta or elsewhere to find work. And you will miss your children. They only come back during Hari Raya. Alright? So you akan rindu. Sekarang Pak Ibu tak perlu rindu lagi. They are staying with you.
you unless you want to kick them out lah.
They're staying with you, they are working in this place, and the pay they're going to get is the same pay in the big cities. We will not take advantage because you are in a different place, we'll pressure for a lower pay home. Same pay as they would expect in big cities. So there's no reason for them to move or migrate to big cities. They stay with you, work here. Makes sense because it goes into the heartstrings. You say, yeah, that's my fear, yeah. My children are leaving the house, they migrate, but hijrah, that's what they call it. And now, with everything, money is here, same pay, staying with me, well, everything is in place. What a wonderful idea. Wonderful idea to them is also a wonderful idea to them. Why? Yes. Imagine I ask you, someone who's working in Jakarta, so very used to city life, a manager, a graduate from there. Ask this person to come in some very ulu place, some very rural place. For example, ask you, come, go to Rantau Panjang to work. Okay, let's go to place in Guang Musang to work. They're from KL. You would never talk about it, right? Even the gaji is there, even the pay is as good as in KL. You wouldn't think about it. So you have people problem or staffing problem. No problem anymore. Now, please remember, this site is there for 40 years. I know you will not see immediate results or immediate graduates to come out here. Give another 10 more years. Okay. They will be the stock, feeding stock to staff. The management positions here. And of course, open up to the people here. Come, we invite you to become production people. Come, why not? Again, a very nice name called Corporate Social Responsibility. Where else can you get staff? Staff or workers in a sort of remote area? Engaging community. Give another 10 more years with this hope and opportunity, it may turn the whole village as a model village where Nestle can capitalize as a public relations success. We have happy face here. What a win-win scenario. That's how stakeholder management turns a hostile situation, or rather, not so supportive institute. If we put our thoughts into it, into the strategy. Okay. So
Utah in Tampa is true,
I'm not sure.
Is it true? Stakeholder management one. But regarding your example, my own experience last time I was doing construction in Jendram. Jendram is a border, it's a Kampung Baru Jendram, is a border of Dengkil and Milai, old road. Okay, project. Okay. So we have orang asli there, orang Melayu there. It's a Kampung of orang asli and orang Melayu lah. So used to do these kind of things.
Engagement.
And in fact, my side office was the Ketua Kampung's house, his second house, rental.
Rental, you
so are. we were like, and then we offered the local people there some job for the project of 2 years duration. Which they came forward to help, actually.
Which is happy because for them they don't have to travel far.
Then the food also, because the story is very far, is catered from one of the village people. Yeah. So the food is, the workers eat
there.
Catered from them. Because you don't have restaurants.
Free?
No, we pay them. Yeah. So we get a business
of and subsidized lah. It's also a business to the community also.
Yes.
So it's a win-win.
Win-win situation now.
So why are we so reluctant, so fearful about residents, about resistance to the project here? Because we do not think hard enough how we can turn the situation over.
So actually, to be honest, so I want to go to the project, so I have to take a big turn, no, actually about 7 kilometers. No. But they taught me a shortcut within 3 minutes through the Labeste. No. Only pick up truck and go in.
And go in.
I mean,
if they don't tell you this, you have to make the whole journey and your fuel cost and everything and the cargo.
So pick up and go in and heavy vehicle can go in.
But motorbike can go in.
But not your car.
So this is why PM board realized that, hey, you know, no longer are those old days where we are pushing people, you know, forcing it through, and using the police or the army in to get everyone, you know, be disciplined and be in orderly fashion. Just have to take that, yeah, I know it comes with a cost, but it looks at the cost of investment of you doing the CSR would reap the multiple level amount of returns of it. So that's where you talk about communicating, interacting, communication skills, information skills, pulling the heartstrings, you know. You wouldn't want your children to work somewhere very far away from you. So that was what they were concerned. You just got it. You just hit the nail. That was their concern or their fear. And you just gave a proposal which solved all their issues and heartaches.